Good afternoon to all. Everyone is listening or not? Okay. So welcome to this whole Android session. Myself Ajay Babar, working with Team Akash. The main goal of this whole Android workshop is to give you a small exposure to an Android so that you can quickly learn and start developing our application as fast as possible, and that is from the day one only, without wasting any time. So I'll quickly go through the overview of the whole Android session. So these many topics we are going to cover in the next three hours. Yeah. So first one is introduction to Android. So that is what I am going to take right now. Then how to build your first Android application, that is Hello World application, and what folder structure or what different folders are present in each Android project. That will be explained by Mitali. Then third one is the Android component. These are the basic building blocks, which includes the activities, services, broadcast receiver, and etc. So that will be explained by Arun. And fourth one is the what different layouts we have in Android, and how to design your user interface or front-end development. So that will be explained by Raya. And then fifth one is the SQLite database. In that we will tell you how to store and retrieve the data from the database. So that will be explained by Tushar. In that we will also have one good example using the SQLite database. And at the end we have Android media. In that we will tell you how to deal with the images, basically multimedia data. So how to play the audio files, video files, so that will be explained by Ninad. So let's start to the introduction to Android. Yeah, basically this will be a theory kind of lecture. So yeah, I just wanted to ask that how many of you have developed the Android applications? Good. That means you know Java very well. Okay. So let's start to the introduction to Android. Okay, can anyone tell what is Android?
Operating system, and?
So these many topics I am going to cover. So first one is introduction, then brief history about the Android, then Android version and the API level. So this is very important topic as a developer to know. Otherwise, his application won't run on his device, okay? Then comparison of Dalvik virtual machine and Java virtual machine. So this is the reason why the Android is so much fast. That is because of Dalvik virtual machine. Then what out-of-box feature Android provides us. And at the end, we have application fundamental. In that, we'll have .apk file. What is it? What is the purpose of it? So all these topics I am going to cover. So let's see one by one.
Yeah. So Android
is a Linux-based operating system specially designed for touchscreen devices like smartphones, tablets, and etc. Initially, it was developed by the Android Inc. and later purchased by the Google in 2005. So Google started working on Android in 2005, and after 3 years, they came up with the first Android-powered device, that is in 2008. Okay, Android is open source. Now see, why Android is so much popular? Because of this reason. Android is open source and Google releases its code under the Apache 2 license. Now what Apache 2 license says is that you derive your code from the original one, modify it according to your requirement and redistribute it. So whatever these hardware manufacturer, what they do, like HTC, Micromax, Samsung, what they do, they just customize the Android according to their requirement and then redistribute it. So no licensing, no paying of royalty, nothing. So it involves zero cost. And because of this, the Android is so much popular. Okay. Then last one is the Google Play Store. You must have heard about this. Okay. So this is very nice place. You can download anything. Like if I want the games, business applications, school applications, you can just, you just need to think and you will have an app for it. Next, yeah, this is just a brief history about the Android. So what different version came in which year? So in 2009 we had a cupcake to eclair. Then in 2010 we had Froyo gingerbread. and this is just a picture, a representation of Android versions. So if you have noticed that these are the alphabetical ordered names, ordered dessert names. Okay, so C for cupcake, D for donut, E for eclair. So I don't know why they, what they made to keep these dessert names, and that is also alphabetical order. Okay. Then in 2011 we had honeycomb ice cream sandwich. Then in 2012 jelly bean. In 2013 the latest current update, that is Android KitKat. So again, these are the pictorial representation. What is API level? Okay, I'll again tell you what is API. API in normal terms, API is an application programming interface that consists of lots of classes, lots of methods that you can actually use in your code. Okay, but why they need API level, means why they need the revisions of API level? So definitely whenever the new API comes into the market, there always be an additive change into on existing one. So old won't be removed, it will be deprecated. So whenever you try it in an Eclipse editor and suddenly comes something like a strike through on a class name or on a method name, that means that class or that method has been deprecated and you have something new available into the market that you can use. So I just wanted to emphasize on this, because whenever the new API level comes into the market, that means you have something new available that you can use. Old won't be removed. Okay. So these API levels have been categorized into the three main groups. That is API level from 3 to 10, specially made for smartphones. Then API level 11 to 13, made for tablets. And after 4 onwards, Android is everywhere. Either it will be a tablet or it will be a smartphone. Okay, this is just for your reference. You can have a look later. So this shows the platform versions, their corresponding API levels, and the version name. So the things marked in red. So Akash tablet uses these two versions. So some Akash tablet has jelly bean, some Akash tablet has ice cream sandwich. So that is Android 4.0.3 has API level 15 and its version name is ice cream sandwich. Okay. So I have mentioned all the API levels, their corresponding version. Okay. So choosing an API level. So this is very important topic as a developer to know. So basically every developer must know which API level his device supports. Okay. So it totally depends on his device. Then what is application forward compatibility and application backward compatibility? So it's pretty logical. Suppose, for example, I have a device with Android version 4.4, that is KitKat. And I compile my program using the ice cream sandwich version. So definitely my program will run, right? Because I am working on a lower level version and I am running that program onto the higher level version. So definitely my program will run. But vice versa may not true. For example, I have a device with an Android version 4.0, that is ice cream sandwich, and I am compiling my application using the jelly bean. So it may be possible that my application won't run, because whenever I am using that new API level, that is whenever I am using the new thing and I am trying to running on old API level, definitely my application won't run. So this is about the application forward compatibility and backward compatibility. Understood na? So Akash tablet uses which version? Ice cream sandwich and jelly bean. And this can be found at main menu setting about tablet. Everyone, I think, know. Okay, Java and Android. So Android is totally based on Java. Okay, but there are subtle difference between the Java and Android. So in Java, we have AWT and Swing for a user interface. You know, right? But in Android doesn't support the AWT and Swing, because we are talking about the touchscreen devices. It needs extensive touch functionality, right? So Android has its own library for user interface. In Java, we have a Java bytecode and Java virtual machine. But in Android, we have a Dalvik bytecode and Dalvik virtual machine. So I'll come to this point in the next slide. And what is Android Java? So what the Android people, what they did, they just remove the AWT and Swing from the Java standard edition, because we are talking about the touchscreen devices, right? So they removed the AWT and Swing components from this Java standard edition, and then they added their own Android API, and which forms the Android Java. Okay, so yeah, this slide shows the comparison between the Java program execution and Android program execution. So let's concentrate on the left hand side diagram. Okay, so we have Java source code, then Java compiler compiles this Java source code and we get the Java bytecode. Okay, and then this executable code runs on the Java virtual machine. Clear? Okay, let's look at the right hand side diagram. What happens at the Android side? We have a Java source code, we have a Java compiler, we get the Java bytecode. Now what happens? Dex compiler comes into the picture. Dex compiler again compile this Java bytecode into the Dalvik bytecode, and this Dalvik bytecode runs on the Dalvik virtual machine. Now the things that are marked in red, it's a new thing introduced by the Android people. So why they need Dex compiler, DVM and all? So basically the Java bytecode is very heavy code. Okay, if you try to decompile it, you will get everything right from your Java files, your resources, everything as it is. But we are talking about what? Touchscreen devices, that is smartphones, tablets. So what Dex compiler do? Dex compiler optimize this Java bytecode into the several layers, and we get the optimized Dalvik bytecode, which is a lightweight code, and that can run on Android devices. Because Android devices has limitations like memory issues, power issues. So what Dex compiler does? Dex compiler optimizes this Java bytecode into the several layers, and then we get the Dalvik bytecode. So this is the reason why the Android is so much fast. Okay, so because of DVM. Understood? Now the differences between the JVM and DVM. So DVM is a register base, JVM is a stack base. So being an engineering student, you must know what is register base and stack base. So I am assuming this, huh? Okay, then also I have one example for you. What is register base and stack base? So here I have a two figure. So upper one is the stack. Upper one is the stack based, and the lower one is the register base. So here I have my stack. And my stack pointer is on the top of the stack, and I wanted to add these two numbers, that is 20 and 7. So what happens here? I need four lines of instruction for adding just two numbers, that is pop 20, pop 7, add 27, store the result into the result, and push the result back to the stack. So I required four lines of instruction, right? But what about in register? In register base, I need only one line of instruction, that is add R3, R1, R2. R1 and R2 are my source, R3 is my destination. So you can see the figure, that operand 5, operand 30, and I stored the result 35 in R3. So I required only one line of instruction, though my instruction length has been increased, but my number of instruction has been decreased, right? So in stack base, we require more instructions as compared to register base. So I'll come to the back slide. Yeah, so this point is get cleared, right? Number of operation in DVM is fewer because it is register base, and for JVM the number of instructions are more, okay, because it's stack based. Then file format. So if we are talking about the Android, so it has a Dalvik bytecode that is .dx file. But in JVM, that is in Java, we have a Java bytecode and it has a .class file. You know, now .class file is there after compiling the source code. So similarly, we have a .dx file in Android because we are using the Dalvik virtual machine. So it converts the Java bytecode into the Dalvik bytecode. Okay. So what Android features we have? So first one is application framework enabling reuse and replacement of component. What is it? See, in Android, the extensive reusability is possible. Okay. For example, suppose my application needs to open the camera, then click the picture and get, and that picture needs to save in gallery. Okay. So I don't need to write each line, every line, line of code for accessing the camera, then clicking the picture, and then again saving back to my gallery. I don't need to write any single line of code because camera application will handle all that functionality. I just need to reuse that functionality and run it. So extensive reusability is possible in Android. Okay. So that was about the enabling the reuse. Then Dalvik virtual machine, as I said, it is optimized for mobile devices. Then SQLite for structured data storage. So we will have a dedicated session on this, that is a permanent data storage. Okay. Then Android also supports the multimedia data like MP3 files, that is audio files, images like JPG, PNG, and the remaining three are the hardware dependent. If your hardware manufacturer provides this functionality, then you can have this. Okay, like GSM telephony, Bluetooth, 3G, Wi-Fi, camera, GPS, everything. Okay, what Akash tablet has features? So Akash tablet supports Jelly Bean, as well as some of Akash tablet supports Jelly Bean, some of Akash tablet supports ice cream sandwich. Then optimized graphics support, Wi-Fi, camera, accelerometer, application fundamental. So, okay, what is APK file?
APK is an application package file.
It's a zip package format based on the jar file format. So it's technically incorrect to relate the .exe file in Windows, like you have .exe file, which installs something on your machine, right? So similarly, in Android, we have a .apk file, but it's technically incorrect to relate .apk with .exe, okay? So for example, I said this. So it's a zip package format based on a jar file format. So what APK holds? So it Java source file, your Java code. Then resources. So what are the resources? Everything other than your code that are resources, like your images, your documents like PDF files, everything that are resources. Similarly with the assets. And then what is manifest file? Manifest file, main puchunga fir se. Kya hai? Bas. Correct. Manifest file defines the your application properties. For example, if I wanted, I said that suppose my application requires to open the camera, so I need to give the permission. Then only that kernel will understand. Yeah, this application requires to open the camera, and he has given the permission into that manifest file. Also, one more example. Suppose if I wanted to use the internet, then also I need to give the permission into the manifest file. So manifest file is a very important file in every Android project.
So this is just for your reference. I just wanted
to tell you that these two links. If you wanted to have Android video lectures, you can just go to these links and watch it. Okay. So you just take it down, or literally I will give you. You can just note down, not a problem. Okay, now I'll call Mitali. She will tell you about how to build your first Android application and what different folders are present in Android project. Okay, thank you.
These are the topics I am going to cover in my talk. That is, what are the packages that are needed for developing an Android application, how to configure and how to create an Android project, and what are the folder structure within a project. first, the prerequisite packages are you need to have JDK 6 and above. You can get it from oracle.com, the site. This is the site. You can download your package based on your bits of the operating system and what type of operating system you are using. Next, the Android SDK. You can get the Android SDK from developers.android.com. This is the site. Again, based on the operating system and the bit of the operating system you are using, you can download the SDK or the zip file. After downloading, you will get a zip file. Just unzip it. You will find a folder something like this. When you double click on it, you will find two folders. One will be the Eclipse folder and another one will be the SDK folder. When you double click on the Eclipse folder, you will find an Eclipse icon. When you double click on the Eclipse icon, its blast player will come up and a pop-up will come, will ask you to set the workspace. Just select the workspace you want to place your files and folders of your project. Otherwise, the Eclipse can by default set the path. Otherwise, you can browse according to your need and according to which folder you want to place your file. Just click on OK. So here is the Eclipse editor where the actual development starts. Next, I will tell you how to configure the AVD. Now, what is AD and AVD? Android SDK package by default provides ADA, that is Android Device Emulator, which is used to run an Android virtual device which emulates a real Android phone. AVD allows you to test your Android application on different Android versions and configuration without access to the real world. Next, how to configure AVD? While in configuring AVD, you need to keep in mind the main factor, that is speed optimization. You can do it in two ways, by the use of Intel system image. That is, I will tell you practically. Go to Window menu, then Android SDK Manager. It will take few seconds to start up. There is a package called Intel x86 Atom System Image. So it is mentioned that here it is not installed, just check it. And the Google APIs, if you want to include any Google APIs in your project, just check it and install the packages. Installation will be it will take some time. If you are a Window user, you need to install another package, that is Intel x86 Emulator Accelerator. It is only for Windows operating system, so after some time it will get installed. Now the second way to optimize the speed is by the use of snapshot option or use host GPU option. To know this, so we need to know how to create an Android virtual device. That is, you just go to Window menu, then Android Virtual Device Manager. Then you just create a new AVD you want. Suppose I write, it is intern. So it is the device I am choosing. Then the file size of the SD card, that is. And here is the option to optimize the speed, that is emulation option. There are two options, that is one is snapshot and another one is use host GPU. If I check the snapshot option, if I check the snapshot option, what it will happen that when you start the AVD for second or subsequent next time, it will resume the previous state. So rendering becomes very fast. If I check the use host GPU option, it will use the graphics card of the host system and for which the rendering becomes very fast. At a time I can't check both of them, it will show a message. So now I am starting the AVD. So lunch, now click on the lunch. It will take few time to start. Yeah, it got started. Now I will tell you one sample application that is basically the Hello World. So go to the file menu, just click on new option, then others, then click on Android, then Android application project, and click on next. The you need to give an application name you want to create. I suppose give hello. Click on next, then check the create custom launcher icon and create activity icon, and check the create project in workspace, then click on next, then browse the image icon you want to keep for the as launcher icon. Suppose I browse it to hello world.png, then you can set the background color you want. Click on OK, then next, just check the create activity, then suppose I select the blank activity, then click on next, then the name of the activity will come. You can give your activity name, any name you can want, then click on finish. So here is the project we have created, it is Hello World of Interns. So coming to the next, that is what are the folder structure in a project, Android project, that SRC folder is there, GEN folder is there, then assets folder is there, bin folder is there, LIBS is there, RES folder is there. So coming to the slide, I will tell you. Here is the folder structure. So SRC folder contains the Java source code file which a program need to write the application, the code he wants for the application. Then GEN file contains the auto-generated file, that is r.java file inside this folder, which contains references for the resources that are being used in your project. RES file contains the resources that you want to use in your project, like images, then XML configuration files. It contains also subfolders to keep resources based on the type, like it differentiate the images file, then differentiate the string values that you want to keep. The subfolder, there is a subfolder inside RES folder, that is value folder. It is used to define string, colors, dimension, style, static arrays of the integer, string or integer. By convention, each type is stored in different files, like string files are stored in string.xml file. There is another folder, there will be values-v11 or values-v14. V11 means that it is using API version 11, and 14 means it is using API version 14. Then the animator folder contains animations. This folder contains animations in XML for the property animation API, which allow you to animate arbitrary properties over time. Layout folder, subfolder contains layout that are being used in your applications. It contains various based on your screen size basically. That is, if you choose default size, it will be subfolder, it will be layout. For small screen size, you can choose, there will be layout-small. For large screen size, there will be layout-large. Then for extra large screen size, you will choose layout-x-large. Then for landscape orientation, you can use extra large-landscape, land. Then for 7-inch tablet or for any tablet, it is 600 dp. And for 10-inch, that is 720 dp, and for multi-pen it is 600 dp. There is another subfolder menu. This folder contains many resources to be used in an application, that is option menu, context menu, sub menus. Then there is a folder, another subfolder, that is raw. It contains raw resources that are looked up by the resource IDs. Every resources you normally use in your project are assigned with IDs that are stored in various resource files. For RES drawable, there is another folder that is drawable. Drawable folder are resource directories in an application that provides different bitmap drawable for medium, high and extra high density screens. For medium density, you can choose, there is MDPI. For high density, it is HDPI. And for extra high density, it is XHDPI. And for no pre-scaling, it is no DPI. There is a folder, all these are four subfolders under RES file. And this is, there is a folder LIBS. If you want to include any extra library file you want to place in your, use in your project, you can place that folder in the, it is by default store. If you browse it, browse through it and keep the jar file in it, so it will be available in LIBS folder. Assets, this folder contains raw hierarchy of files and directories with no other capabilities. It is just an unstructured hierarchy of file allowing you to put anything you want there and later review as raw byte stream. The main difference between RES and asset is that in asset, you can unstructured data is stored that is not viewed or accessible by Android build system directly. But RES folder contains structured data which is directly accessible by Android build system. In bin directory, you will be having your APK files. Then Android manifest.xml. This is a very important file in every application. Used to have need to have this Android manifest.xml file in the root directory. It contains essential information about the application to the Android system. It contains information the system needs before running an application. It is just like a control file which describes the application permissions and the component about the components, nature of the components as well. It determines also which process will host the application component. It also describes the permission that other component needs in order to interact with other components of an or within a component within in, it is just like an inter communication between component. So the permission is set over here. It declares the minimum label of Android API that application requires. That's all. Thank you.
Let's talk about Android application components. All right. So, components of Android, what comes to your mind? A 5 megapixel camera, 8 megapixel camera, V5, a 5-inch display. Components, we all use smartphones, right? Sabke paas Android phone hai. So these things come to our mind, right? Ki Android ka components wahi sab ho sakta basically. You guys are familiar with Hindi? Or South people are there? It's alright, I'm from South, it's pretty fine. Yeah, so basically from a developer's point of view, like we are thinking, like I'm an Android developer, from a developer point of view, Android application components means the small components and basically building blocks which we use to like construct each and every application in Android. So if we just name them, they are like there are major four categories of them. Like few of us, you already he told few activities, services and stuff, so you might be familiar with these. So yeah, activities, services, broadcast receivers and content providers. These are like four major like types of components in Android. And there are a few more also, but we won't be like jumping into stuff. As I said, this will be just a brief about things. So yeah, these are like big names, right? Like content providers, broadcast receivers. Oh my God, what are these? But to be frank, these are like really simple stuff which you guys use in your daily life. We all use applications in you have like touchscreen devices these days. Okay. So let's jump into the first one and you'll be like knowing ki ye kya hai basically. So the first thing is activity, and this is like the most important one, the most important component in Android. So activity is simply a user interface. Alright. So in any application, each and every UI that you see, every screen that you interact with is an activity. So let's take some examples, like if I'm playing a game and I'm like interacting with the screen, it's an activity. I'm using my browser or viewing a map, using a chat app. All this is activity. Like, so since I said every screen is an activity, you won't argue if I say that each and every application can have multiple activities, right? So let's imagine that we are creating an application, like she just created a Hello World of Intern 2014. Okay, some application, right? So in that application, I want to create a UI basically. My first screen, let's say. So I want to create an activity. So the first thing I need to do is jump into my manifest file. By the way, what is manifest file? Abhi kya tha? Exactly. I can't hear what you're saying, but yeah, theek hai. You guys remember something at least. So basically in manifest file, we need to mention ki apne app mein what all things are there. Theek hai, do we have activity services, permissions and everything. So since here we are interested in creating an activity. So let's, I guess you can see the these tags. So this is my simple XML file. Theek hai. So there is an application tag over here, which is specific to my so-called app. So inside that, I'll just go ahead and add a new tag named activity. That means I'm adding a new activity, and there's an attribute name. So basically I'm specifying, I'm just giving some name for my activity. Let's call it example activity. So now my manifest knows that this app contains one activity named example activity. So once this is done, what I can do is I can go ahead and actually write an activity. So in my Java file, told you that there is a SRC folder, uske andar you have a Java file and stuff. So in my Java file, I'll create a class having the same name, which I had mentioned in my manifest. And now we'll extend this as activity. So basically there's a super class in Android named activity. So this tells Android, hey boss, this example activity is a UI. It's an activity. It will have click listeners and stuff onto it. So since we are extending a super class, it's obvious that we can override many of its, you guys are familiar with Java, right? So uske sab jo bhi classes hain, we need to override them. So most of them are optional basically, but few of them are important. You can see onCreate method over here. There is on resume, on pause, on start, destroy, and lots of stuff. So basically these methods, which are overrided from the, the activity super class, can be summarized as lifecycle method. So each activity basically from its birth to its death goes through a life cycle. So basically states, when it gets started, it is running, it is paused. You guys must be familiar with these things already. So in Android, we basically have this activity life cycle. So basically, it's just showing how an app starts and how it completes its journey to its end basically. काफी theoretical लग रहा है movie जैसा. But yeah, let's take an example. Suppose I have a movie app. Okay, I like watching movies, so I start a movie. So basically, I am seeing a movie. There's a interface, right? So it's an activity. So I'm watching my movie. So as and when I'll open it, when the activity is launched, the it is being created, right? So there is a method called onCreate. So inside that, I'll write each and every initialization code and stuff like that, which I need to do at the startup basically. Then we have onStart and stuff like that. Then imagine my app is running smoothly. I'm watching a movie, I'm enjoying it. And there is a really nice, interesting scene going on. I mean, fighting scene, obviously. And that moment, my friend just called me, for example. So what will happen? My phone will ring, yaar. Come on. Call aa raha hai mere ko. Pause kya? Theek hai, by the way, it's right. So mera movie pause hoega, obviously. And why is it happening? Because there's a more important activity. It is coming in between it, and it is dude, just get away, mirko aana. And there's a screen, it's coming up and saying, your stupid friend is calling, and there's an image of your friend. Okay, so what happens to our movie activity? It is getting paused, or wo background mein chala jata. So, usually what happens if I'm playing a game, and abruptly, agar wo stop hota hai, So it might happen that I'm on the last level or main wapas start karu to start se chalu jayega. So in that case, obviously I'll go and kill my friend and I'll end up in a jail, right? So thanks to on pause method, we can write specific code in that. So let's say there is another activity coming in between while I'm playing a game, then I can save the levels, save the score. So I'll do all these things in the on pause method, and then I'll tell the call activity basically, to ki haan bhai tu aaja fir, theek hai. And when the call is done, he'll move out, and my game will resume or the movie will resume basically. To resume that, obviously we have an on resume method also. So these are like basically simple stuff. तुम लोग देखोगे तो भी समझ जाओगे बेसिकली इट्स प्योर इंग्लिश एंड ऑब्वियसली इफ इफ माय गेम एंड्स और आई एम बोर्ड और एनीथिंग आई विल स्टॉप माय ऐप्स ऑन स्टॉप मेथड ऑन डिस्ट्रॉय मेथड एंड फाइनली द एक्टिविटी शट्स डाउन सो वन इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग हैपनिंग हियर इज द टू एक्टिविटीज बेसिकली दे आर इंटरेक्टिंग विद ईच अदर सो दीज कैन बी एक्टिविटीज फ्रॉम अ सिंगल एप्लीकेशन और एक्टिविटीज फ्रॉम डिफरेंट एप्लीकेशंस Basically, they are interacting with each other. This calling activity is coming in between. Ki are bhai, emergency hai, zara tu baju mein hat. Theek hai, it comes in and it tells ki ha, I'm leaving, you can come back in. So how is this interaction going on in Android? So an interesting thing comes into the picture called intents. Now intents are basically a message passing mechanism kind of stuff in Android, using which an activity can request a particular action from another activity. So I'll show you a simple code snippet of how easily you can like interact. So imagine we are in the first activity which we just created, the example activity. So I'll create an object, my intent of type intent is equal to new intent, and there are two parameters. The first one is the context, so this, and the second is the name of the activity to which we are like aiming, all right, which we want to start or we want to request anything. So let's say a second activity dot class, because it's a class. So finally I'll write start activity my intent, so this will just go on and pause my app and start the other activity. Similarly, to start a service you will write start service and stuff. So isse zyada deep mein jaane ka zarurat nahi hai filhal, so I'll wind up here for activity khush mato. So moving on to the services. Now unlike activities, services are a bit different. Okay. So services are basically things like they say long running operations jo hote hain, which we would like to run them in the background. Okay. We don't need a UI, we don't need to like interact with them directly. So we use services at places like that. Like simple examples would be like you're downloading some stuff from your internet, you're installing some game from the Play Store. You click install, you don't need to worry ki mera Play Store khula hai ki nahi. You can close it, you can lock your phone, you can throw it away. You will be assured that your app will be installed, because there is a service running which is taking care of all these things. So it does not have a user interface. And yes, there are a few more examples here. Listening music, obviously. You're chatting with your friends and you're listening music. The music piche baj raha hai. You can't see it, but you can hear it. So services, obviously, and similar to activities in Android, in the manifest, if I'm adding a service, I'll put a tag for the service with some name, let's say hello service, and I'll create a class with the same name, hello service, but this time I'll be extending service rather than activity, because we don't need a UI, we don't need any kind of interaction, we want this to run in the background. Third one is broadcast receivers. Now these are like pretty interesting stuff. Like these are receivers for like broadcast announcements being made in Android. This is like huge statement. Break it down. Okay. So in Android there are specific events being which happens, like a alert, there is a phone call coming. Alert, there is a SMS like received. Your battery is running low. So there might be some activities or applications who must be interested in certain types of like these announcements. Okay, for example, let's say I have a camera application. So it's clicking a picture. Okay, I mean, ek pic le liya. There might be few applications like gallery, Instagram, let's say Facebook. these might be interested in like interested in the getting the image which is captured and like doing something like editing ya fir are bhai share kar de show it on your put it on your wall something like that theek hai and there might be other applications like the music app or the weather app they have like nothing to do with the image being captured so only the applications which are interested in like receiving certain types of what do you say announcements they register themselves to receive those announcements and obviously these components can help you to get notified whenever such events occur theek hai like agar battery low hua to there is a pop up ki bhai lagana chahe agar what are you doing theek hai so stuff like that and the fourth one is content providers now these are interesting because this is the only way using which two applications in Android can share data all right there is no shared file ka funda there is no shared memory thing in this so simple example to take with is phone contacts so we have a phone contact ka application in our phone right we save all our friends name and details in it but you would have noticed that applications like WhatsApp Viber they fetch number from the contact you don't need to like go into WhatsApp and like feed in the numbers again right so this is because the phone contact application it provides its content to the interested applications so other apps like Viber and stuff they use the provider which is made by the contact app they register themselves that bhai mere ko contacts chahiye so they register themselves and they pull out the data from other apps so for this we use content providers now there are few more things like few more types of components like app widgets and stuff they are like we won't be like talking about them right now even the four we talked about now like activity services content providers and broadcast receivers it is not mandatory that like every app of yours should have all of these like my app can have only activities it can have like five activities two services and no content providers it's okay so basically these are like blocks you can use them as and how you require and you can build your app so just to wind up things let's take an example and I want you guys to like speak up and tell me theek hai so let's talk about whatsapp everyone know whatsapp nahi I can't hear you is there anyone who does not have a idea what whatsapp is it's okay like no one okay nice I'm blessed so in whatsapp just because we all are whatsapp users is there an activity which one one by one anyone from this side clap for me aise bola and clap for me also theek hai so yeah so we have a lot of activities in it so are there any like services running this side no I feel like sitting in a concert right ha theek hai this side
notifications or like if you have some order app or
okay anything else downloading music and videos so anyone has a different opinion in what he said notifications aate hain so wo dikhata hai so there is a service for that can't hear you server theek hai sorry no so basically what I am asking is theek hai what she said was absolutely right like we are downloading a video theek hai I'll click download I don't need to be like staring at the chat screen ki are bhai khatam kab hoga we all know 2g 3g network sucks really hard so basically what I'll do is I'll just stop my app I mean press my home key I'll do my useful work apart from whatsapp and I'll come back and watch the music or video later on So that service. Now, what you said, I don't remember your name, you just met me here. What he said was notifications. So, exactly. So that was I wanted to. So basically, those are events. There is like you're receiving an SMS or you're receiving a message in WhatsApp. So there is some kind of events being triggered. So broadcast receivers come into picture at that point. So messaging basically. And content providers, contacts obviously. Main wo likha bhi tha wahan pe. So yeah, I guess this session was interesting. I hope so. And yeah, I'll announce a tea break.